Thank you so much, Dr. Sundararaman, for joining us. So, first of all, the Supreme Court's decision was quite welcome yesterday, and it may. So, do you think it marks a major change in the amount of testing that might happen, or just because it's become free, does it necessarily mean that we could see a rapid increase in tests?
No, I don't think. First, I think it's a welcome decision, and I hope the government implements it in all seriousness. But somewhere, I noticed in one of the television interviews that there is a restriction that the private sector tests only the samples referred to it.
Okay.
That would defeat the purpose. That would become another form of ensuring that the people tested and the sort of cases which are tested are kept under severe restrictions, and there is a systematic underprojection of the underestimation of the disease that is done. I think that the rule should be that the private sector is free to test anybody who has clinical symptoms suggestive of COVID-19, clinical symptoms suggestive of COVID-19 if the doctor prescribes it.
Right.
And that the government would be bound to reimburse the amount at a fixed rate. That rate can be negotiated. I think their present rate is 4,500. I'm sure they will be willing to negotiate a lower amount, but they should not charge anybody because then there will be a tendency to overthink. But if their own physician, even a private physician, suggests that this is a COVID-19 differential diagnosis, then it should be tested. And I don't think the government should limit that test ability, but they should be reimbursed for it. Otherwise, they cannot test. It's fair enough. And there are ways of standard ways of costing the testing. And at some point, we can work that out. We have worked out for differential diagnosis. It can be done immediately. But essentially, it is usually negotiated. It should be negotiated. But they should implement it and should not have restrictions on whom to test. Of course, government can refer patients to them for testing and say they will be duty-bound to test whatever government refers. But they can, in addition, test anybody whom they think should be tested.
So, also, last time we spoke, which is about a couple of weeks ago, we had clearly marked that there was a huge testing problem in India, that we were under-testing considerably. So, especially over the past 2 to 3 weeks, do you see that this situation has been ameliorated to some extent, or are we still progressing in the same way?
Ameliorated to some extent is a very, very little it's nowhere near the scales we are talking about.
Right.
But it is increasingly clear that the restrictions on testing are not only test kits. Mm-hmm. They are also at some point to paint a profile of the disease as you would have it and not let thing go. So, now, for example, even with severe acute respiratory infection, what is called SARI, not every SARI is being tested. There is screening, there is X-ray, and then only at one point after admission, they are testing. Some states are saying we test only 50% of them, which is absolutely negligent. But even if you test all of them so late and such a strict criteria for testing, means, what does it mean? It means that people who have mild and moderate infections are walking around in the population. They are seeking health care. So they will appear as non-COVID patients before healthcare providers. And you would expect a lot of healthcare providers to fall sick. Is that happening? That is happening all over the place. The cancer hospital, Jaslok Hospital, Wokhard Hospital. Mm-hmm. It was not people who were in the COVID-19 line of duty who have been quarantined. These are people seeing the general outpatient. Why? Because by design, you are allowing people who are mild and moderate cases not to be tested. Now, to the extent that the private sector laboratory testing allows those people to be tested, the government will lose control of the picture it wants to paint. For example, you have tested the Tablighi cohort, the patients who were there, see them as a cohort, that you have tested. To the extent that they were tested, it was well done. I'm not critical of that. I'm welcoming them. But there are many other cohorts. And to maintain a narrative that it is other than this cohort, there is no other cohort, we are actually not testing many people who have the symptoms but and deserve to be tested, need to be tested. If you open it up to the private sector, it is not the money of reimbursement that I think concerns the government. Right. It is opening up testing in a way that the narrative will spin out of the government control.
And in this context, could you talk a bit about the effectiveness of what are being called the quicker tests, which can be done much shorter, but which have a much more, say, unpredictable result, set of results?
Okay, that's a good question. The rapid test is an antibody test. There couldn't be antigen test, but we don't have that. We have an antibody test. Now, that test, in the first phase of the disease, that is before symptoms develop, patient is infected for 2 to 3 days. And in the first 2 or 3 days after the fever develops, that test can give false negatives. So it's not a useful test in the early phase. So it's not a useful test for the first test of a quarantine patient. But if a patient comes with symptoms, if the protocol is to test anybody with fever and likely symptoms after 3 days, then the test is very useful. So the test is never to be interpreted alone. It is to be interpreted in a clinical setting. And my contention is, despite the problems of negativity and positivity, it will be certainly a very, very valid test, because tests are always interpreted in a clinical context.
Right.
Now, the other problem with the test is, suppose you test 6 months later, because it is antibodies, it will still be positive, though the patient is no longer infected. That's a false positive. But that's not really a false positive. It is actually telling a different story. You know that the patient is not fever febrile now, but you know, and if you are in doubt, you can always repeat with a viral test.
Right.
So a lot of severe cases are being handled in the ICU, and the test, COVID-19 viral test, comes too late. But now with this rapid test, at least they will know they are dealing with it, and because by the time it is severe, it is usually positive. It will be positive. So they will be able to at some point pick, well, I don't know that they will be positive, but likely to be positive. So they will be much safer to do that. So I think the coming of this test is to be welcomed. And if we get the thing right, it's all right. Now, it should not be used for population survey and picking up early cases and then saying people are tested negative, and that it's not a good test for a population survey. Good test only in a patient who has developed clinical symptoms.
Right.
And or if you want to see at discharge whether the patient has developed immunity. As a research population survey, it's useful. It is useful in population surveys not to detect cases for quarantine, but to understand the spread of the disease. Mm-hmm. How many people have been asymptomatic, etc. It's a good test.
Right. So the Delhi government, for instance, has announced a plan to actually test nearly 1 lakh people at random. And this is almost close to what the entire country has tested. So do other states also, for instance, need to do that kind of mass testing at a random level?
It's not a very large number. You're talking of 2 crore population. You're talking of a population that is very near South Korea, which is 3 crores.
Right.
So you're not talking of a very large population. Okay. And Tamil Nadu has also ordered 1 lakh tests. Kerala has also ordered 1 lakh tests. Chhattisgarh wanted to order 50,000 or something. So a lot of people have ordered it. So I would still call this a minimal testing regime at 1 lakh. So I'm not going to say 1 lakh is too much. 1 lakh is possibly too little. Remember that for positive patients, you need 3 tests. So the number of people tested and the number of samples tested are not the same. There was a very interesting article that showed that it differed by only 890, absurd, obviously rigged. But you would test positive people twice more to ensure that they have turned negative to discharge them.
Right.
In quarantine patients, you would need to test on the 5th day and the 14th day to know that they are clear of the disease. So in some sense, you are talking of more tests per patient. Having said that, a random sample, if it is properly randomized and sampled, it is all right. But I would say that the emphasis should be on test. If you do totally random sample, then your pool is also uninfected people, infected and asymptomatic. And I would be happy if they were to do even the all patients with symptoms and symptoms defined in a liberal way, not make it too tight. For example, some people are putting breathlessness as a necessary symptom. It's not. It's not a necessary symptom for mild disease. So in some sense, if you within that you test, you would have done a great service. At least you would know the different cohorts. You would find that there is not one Tablighi Mafraf thing, but there are many such cohorts, and you would do justice to what you need to do in terms of a testing protocol.
Thank you so much for talking to us, Dr. Sundararaman.